Oshkosh Today, your connection to events and organizations in the Oshkosh area.
Welcome to the first Oshkosh Day of 2017. As the winter season continues, we've got some awesome segments showing just why Oshkosh is the place to be. The annual Otter Street Fishery is anticipated all year long, and we'll hear all about the details of this year's event. If you're a music fan, enjoy singing, performing, or just listening, you'll love the Winnebagoland Barbershop Chorus. EAA always has a lot going on, and one of their most popular events, Hops and Props, is just around the corner. We'll meet another Friends of OCM Student Athlete of the Year finalist, John Sitter, from Oshkosh North. The episode will wrap up with a segment of Focus on Health with our friends at Aurora.
Oshkosh Today. Oshkosh Today is supported in part by the Friends of OCM and Aurora Healthcare, 855 North West Haven Drive. Set design provided by House of Flowers, 1920 Algoma Boulevard.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Oshkosh Today, your source for all of the awesome local events and organizations that are right here in our city of Oshkosh. I'm your host, Emily Springstro. We have another wonderful show lined up for today with a lot of great things to look forward to over the next couple of months. We're going to go ahead and get right into it with our very first guest of the show, and our first guest of 2017, I have to say. I'd like to welcome our friend Scott Engel here from the Otter Street Fishing Club, here to talk about the upcoming fishery. So Scott, welcome.
Thanks, Emily.
Yes, it should be an honor. You're here 2017, first guest of the year.
It is. Happy to be here.
Yes, it's great to have you. We're here to talk about the fishery on February 4th. Before we get into the details on that specific day, there is kind of a fun kickoff event for the weekend, and that's Brandon's Bash, taking place on February 3rd. Where is that going to be?
Absolutely. It's right in the tent that we have our fishery in. It's the night before. It's become a very big event for us. We'll have the band Star 6-9 playing that night from 7 to 11. It's a heated tent. I mean, we go to a lot of work to make sure that tent is nice and comfortable for everybody. It's in the parking lot, Miller's Bay, so it's not on the ice, and it's just a really great event. It's in memory of a younger member that passed in a tragic accident. His friends and family have taken that event over and basically volunteered their time to the event to make something that he was passionate about into a big event for us.
Mm-hmm. It is so fun. I went last year, and the tent, you're right, it's nice and warm and comfortable, and it's almost worth leaving your coat in the car and shivering on your way into the tent because it's perfect.
It's very surprising because sometimes you walk into that tent and people are dressed, let's say it's not like you'd expect at a fishery.
Right.
You walk into the tent and you're like, where are the snowmobile suits and heavy boots and everything? Everybody's just having a great time, and it's a big group of people, a great celebration.
Yes, great chance to get to know some of the people that are taking part in the fishery. And for people like me who don't necessarily fish, it's a good time for me to come and say hi to everybody before it gets going.
Something for everybody.
Yes. So we've got that on the 3rd. That takes place at what time, 6 o'clock?
Tent opens at 6 o'clock. The band starts approximately 7 o'clock.
Perfect. So we've got that to kick it off. And then the next day is the main event. That's the Otter Street Fishery, Saturday, February 4th. What's going to be going on that day?
Now, this is our traditional fishery that the club originated on, and this had always been our number one fundraiser. We sell raffle tickets. Raffle tickets now are $3 a piece. We got some very major prizes on there with $3,000 cash as top prize. Second is a weekend for two, Vegas with flight and hotel, all that. You know, a lot of great prizes on that. We also have a fishing portion of the fishery. Fishery it is, you know. Mm-hmm. So you have to buy a $10 ticket to weigh a fish, but then out of all the fish weighed that day, they will randomly draw for a $1,000 top prize and a $500 prize. So there's a lot of different things. There's kids games where we have, you know, the hay bales and candy and coins in there, and different kind of little games for the kids. And then it's the social hour also that the fishery has. There's the paddle wheel and all the other things that are going on in the tent that day. So it's It's our traditional fishery, and it's a great time.
A little something for everyone. I like that there's something for the kids. It really kind of encourages families to get out there. And you've kind of restructured a little bit, too, with the fishery, you know, with the raffle portion of the tickets that you're doing.
Right. You know, so we did go up a dollar on our regular raffle, but I'd like to talk more about the fishing portion. That's mm-hmm. where we just didn't see the fishing as much as we used to see. And we looked at what Battle on Bagel had done with theirs, and we think they had a great idea. And ours is just a very smaller version of it. We call it the pre-battle challenge. And it's only $10 a ticket. You have to pay $10, and you can weigh one fish. You can buy as many of those $10 tickets as you want. So if you want to spend $100 on tickets and weigh 10 fish, we've got prizes in four categories for that, which is northern, walleye, white bass, and panfish. So we pay the top three in those categories plus those random drawings. So as this takes gets a little bigger over the years, we're going to expand the amount of money paid out on that too as we start seeing more participation.
Mm-hmm. So not as high of a competition for the biggest fish. It's kind of a fun way to, if you get a fish,
absolutely
throw
could
it
be
in.
Could be a little perch, could be a little white bass, but if you're randomly drawn and your name comes out, you might just get $1,000 for that little perch or white bass or whatever.
That might be enough to get me out there on the ice too. A lot of prize opportunities you had mentioned for the other raffles as well. Really great things going on. And I have to ask how the event is supported and how does something like this take place? It's a big event, a lot of great prizes. You got to have some sponsors that you got to.
Yeah, we've got 15 major sponsors that basically, the minimum to be a major sponsor of Otter Street is about $1,500 a year. And some of them go up quite above that. Mm-hmm. And that helps take some costs, but they're involved in all our events, you know. So we have their signage and try to give them as much as we can bang for their buck for supporting our club. We do have a lot of other donors that donate, like with this this raffle. There's going to be probably between 200 and 300 prizes from area businesses where there could be $10 gift certificates to your favorite restaurant, to car washes, movies, bowling, whatever. There's all those type of prizes are mixed in. And there's a lot of different ways to win too.
Mm-hmm. And it's great to hear that, you know, the local support and the community support that comes into an event like this. The Otter Street Fishery, that's Oshkosh. I mean, people think about Oshkosh when they hear that club. And you know, a lot of contests. We talked about the fishing portion, but as you can see on screen, there's a lot of other things that are going on too. Some really exciting and looks like a little scary. So
right.
tell us about what we're looking at.
Yeah, this is something crazy. I sit and watch and wonder a lot. I had a friend who used to do this, and he had some really bad wrecks. And amazing these kids, what they do out there. They're hitting some incredible speeds on ice with studded tires and everything. And that's right there in the bay. You can view that right from our tent. But they come out there, and that's another portion of the entertainment we have out there that day.
Mm-hmm. Really something you cannot see anywhere else.
No, not really.
Very fun. What do the proceeds go towards?
Goes towards the betterment of conservation and on Lake Winnebago and the Winnebago chain. So we do a lot of different things as far as we've done projects with the DNR. We've bought them a $30,000 shocking boat. We've done some things to try to bring the sauger back, called sandpike also, mm-hmm. back into the lake along with walleyes for tomorrow. We've done things with reefs. We've bought fishing piers. We've helped with boat launches. A lot of various things. And even here in City Hall, where parks directors and things come for different ideas, as long as it has to do with something that has to do with fishing or conservation on Lake Winnebago and the Winnebago chain, we're all for it.
Mm-hmm. And that's something to keep in mind. A lot of people are familiar with the Otter Street Fishery, but aren't really familiar with the Otter Street Fishing Club in itself. So it's great to hear kind of an overview of what you guys do. If someone's looking for more information about what you guys do at the Otter Street Fishing Club, where can they go?
Well, come see me at Jerry's Bar. I'm a familiar face there. The number there is 231-7380. You can also call me on my personal cell anytime with questions, and that's 379-9493. And honestly, we can go then to our website, and we also have Otter Street Fishing Club on Facebook, so you can get a hold of us through any of those four ways.
Mm-hmm. A lot of different ways to get information and get involved. Once more, before we run out of time here, when is the fishery and where is it going to be?
It's going to be Miller's Bay, Menominee Park, Friday, February 3rd, and Saturday until 5. This is an afternoon event on Saturday. We kind of try to make it an afternoon event because the next day is Super Bowl Sunday.
That's
so we know
right.
Everybody's, you know, roaring up for that too. Also, one other thing for ice conditions on Lake Winnebago, Don Herman, who runs our plows and bridges, keeps a very updated page on Facebook under Sunk Dive and Ice. He also owns that company, and he keeps a very, very detailed report about roads, bridges, where everything is on the lake, and that's the best way to get ice information in our general area.
Which is extremely important, too.
It is. It's changing all the time.
Mm-hmm, definitely. Well, thank you for that update as well. And Scott, I have to thank you again for coming in. We cannot wait for the fishery. I personally can't wait for Brandon's bash. And good luck with the final phases of planning.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having us.
Definitely. Coming up next, we'll chat with the Winnebagoland Barbershop Chorus about an upcoming show that they've got going on, as well as their organization in general. We'll be right back.
You've been waiting for it, and it's finally here. The 2017 OCM card is on sale now. The OCM card offers discounts at 22 Oshkosh businesses and can be used for the entire year. Available for purchase at Hardee's, Two Brothers Family Restaurant, and local nonprofits, the OCM card is still only $10. The OCM card is the gift of savings for the whole year. For more information about the OCM card, visit friendsofocm.org. Get yours today and support Oshkosh Media for only $10.
Our climate is changing. Making a few changes around the office can cut carbon emissions. Shut off your computer, monitor, and other electronics when you're not using them. Turn off the lights in rooms you're not using. Recycle paper and plastic. Print on both sides of the paper. And buy office products that use recycled content. Reduce your carbon impact to the environment. Act now on climate change.
Welcome back to Oshkosh Today. Thanks again for joining us. Now we're joined by our second guest for the show. We have the Winnebagoland Barbershop Chorus, and we've got our friends Art Lose and Keith Krenke here to tell us all about an upcoming show that they have called Yeehaw, as well as just what they do as a club and an organization. So without further ado, welcome to Art and Keith. Thanks. You for joining us today.
Thank you for having us here.
And you wore your great shirts, which I always love when people have their matching outfits, so very nice. And we're here to talk about an upcoming show. You're in the midst of preparing for it. When is it going to be happening?
It's scheduled for Saturday, March 25th, and it'll be at the Alberta Kimball Auditorium.
Okay, and the title of the show I already gave away. I love it. It's called Yeehaw. Give us a little bit of a background on where the inspiration for that came from.
Well, it's a takeoff from the old TV show Hee-Haw.
Ah.
And so a lot of those skits will be in there, the cornfield, the barbershop, different settings, you know, different parts, and the one-liner jokes. It's just going to be a lot of fun.
So much fun. And before we get into the details of the show, why don't we give us a little overview of the Winnebagoland Barbershop Chorus in general, for those of us who don't know who you guys are.
We're a group of guys, about 40, and we get together on Tuesday nights and rehearse songs that are part of the International Organization of Barbershop Singers. And we learn those songs more by just repeating them, by rote, like when we were kids and you would just learn a song over and over and over again. And by doing it each Tuesday night, we learn those songs. And whenever we get together, we can sing them together. And singing is just a fun thing to do. And I think it's just relaxing for anyone that would like to give it a try.
Definitely. And you sound phenomenal. I've heard you guys sing before. We're going to have you in on the next episode to give us a little sampling of your Valentine's Day promotion. But it's, like you said, it's a great opportunity to get together, make some friends, and relax a little bit, do some singing.
A lot of guys in the audience probably sing with church choirs.
Ah.
And they like to sing, but for some reason they might be afraid to come to sing with us. But it's really nice. We have four part, just like you do in a church choir. It's usually soprano, soprano, alto, tenor, bass. We call it lead, is where the melody is. But it's close harmony. And when it's done right, it kind of makes the hairs on your arm stand up. You know, if you sing the national anthem, uh-huh. for example, in four-part harmony, it's really stirring.
Yes.
And we want everybody to enjoy that, to come down and join us.
Definitely.
We have a blog on there. There are names of people you can call if you're interested. You can call me, you can call Art, we'll pick you up, we'll take you down, we'll sit next to you, we'll explain things to you, and just, you know, we want people to join us.
Yes, I love that. Low pressure, not too much intimidation going on with this group. And, you know, it's open for, I guess, anyone, correct?
Yes.
So you don't have to have experience reading music, like you said, and you don't have to have all that much experience singing as long as you love it, and I guess you can kind of hold a tune, right?
I think we have 3 high school students now,
oh, great.
A couple in college. Then, of course, it's all the way up to, what, 80, 90?
Yep.
Now, once you sing, you can sing all your life. Mm-hmm. If you're in athletics and you're a football player, you can play to, what, 30, 37? That's it. Singing, you can do it forever.
Never expires, does it? So let's get into the show. It's called Yeehaw. You gave us a little bit of a preview of some of the snippets that we can expect, some of the fun little jokes and things. But what kind of pieces are we going to be looking at for what you'll be singing in this show?
We'll be doing some songs that we learn at international type of songs, but there's going to be some parodies and some where we'll take songs that you might have heard before, like I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now, and the parody would be I Wonder Who's Milking My Cow. And so silly things, things to get entertaining.
Mm-hmm.
Get the crowd laughing and enjoying themselves, along with, as Keith has mentioned, about the types of jokes that you heard on the Hee Haw show, and having fun with that. And there'll be some quartets within our group that'll sing other songs that are of that type of,
genre, I guess.
The
you
genre,
say.
or even just
hard to say there's
making fun of different types of things.
Definitely.
And having fun.
How fun. It sounds like the audience should come prepared to laugh, that's for sure.
Yeah.
And you can really tell when the performer is having a good time too. And I think this will be a total example of that it's just everyone in the room is going to be having a great time. You mentioned the featured quartets. There is one specific one that you had promoted a little bit. Maybe you can tell us about them.
Well, they are called the Midnight Croon. Mm-hmm. They compete internationally. They have become the Land O'Lakes District champions, and that has got them notoriety within the organizations. Mm-hmm. And so they come and perform on our show as a separate segment, and features themselves. And they'll be doing songs of barbershop style. They'll have a parody or two, mm-hmm. and they'll tell a few jokes. And they really look forward to entertaining a crowd.
Mm-hmm. Well, that sounds like a very special little, you know, little nugget of the show that we can look forward to.
Yes.
For those of us who are interested, where can we get tickets?
Well, they'll be sold at the door.
Mm-hmm.
And also there are all of the members have availability for tickets. By looking on our webpage, you can find phone numbers to mm-hmm. contact people, but they're people like Mike Gray, our president, Greg Belmer, part of our sales, Roger LaPointe, and on our webpage,
mm-hmm.
www.barbershopsingers.org.
Definitely. And you can also go to the website if you're interested in joining. Always accepting new members, or is there a certain time of the year?
Sometimes people will go to the show and they'll get really enthusiastic and they want to join. That's fine. Join after the show. If mm-hmm. you join now, you might be in the show, which is kind of cool.
Yes. Very cool.
Yeah. And we have take away from Artie.
No, that's all right.
Well, we have 2 shows now.
Uh-huh.
Before, we'd always have an evening show. We're going to try a matinee this year.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll have a choice to come during the daytime or in the evening.
Definitely. And what times are those shows? The matinee is at
2 p.m.
2 o'clock, and then
at 6:30.
Perfect. So a lot of different opportunities to come out and see you. Tickets, I think, are $15.
That is correct.
Yeah, so really, it's a great opportunity to support a local group and have a great time, a cheap night out. I mean, it doesn't get any much better than that, does it?
No, it doesn't.
And then go ahead.
I want to also promote that after the show, the 6:30 show, that'll get over about 8:30, 9 o'clock, and then in what's called the O Room of Oshkosh West High School, where the auditorium is part of the campus, we will have what we call an afterglow, where quartets will get up and sing some more songs, and it's a relaxed atmosphere. We'll serve a few beverages and a sandwich, and then just have some more fun. Along with the featured quartet, we'll also sing a few songs.
Very fun. Do any of the audience members get a chance to sing anything in the afterglow and get up there and break a few?
We've had some people actually come up and join.
We've said any barbershoppers in the audience, they'll say five or six, well, come on up here. And
there's
a couple what we call woodshed songs. If I went out to California and I went to a chapter there, I would know some of the songs they do because they're called woodshedding songs. And so they'll sing with us. And that's kind of cool.
Wonderful. Well, we're just about closing in on our time, but you do have a lot of other shows coming up. About how many shows do you usually do per year?
Well, we've made a list here of all the different things that we could think of as 29.
Oh my goodness.
Some of these, like we combine with the Optimist Club, they have a dinner show. Mm-hmm. We combine with them and we both benefit from that to gain money we can give away to scholarships and things like that. We do the Watoma Volunteer Fire Department, we do a show for them. We do the Valentine sing-outs are coming up, we do those things.
Wide variety of different things.
There's always something to do. And some people say, well, if I can't come to every rehearsal, can I come to these things? Yes. The only thing we require is that you know the music to perform. Mm-hmm. If you can do that coming every other rehearsal, that's fine. But that's the only requirement that we have. If bad weather, you can't make it, well, that's fine. Mm-hmm. If you're out of town, that's fine. Come when you can, just make it on a regular basis so that you can perform with us.
Great. Well, hey, thanks, gentlemen, for coming by and promoting your show coming up on
March 25th.
March 25th at Alberta Kimball. And we'll see you on the next episode. I don't want to give too much away, but we'll be talking Valentine's
Day. one thing, Alberta Kimball, I come from Berlin, and some people ask me, where is that? That's actually West High School.
Yes.
Okay, the auditorium at West High School, so let's sneak that in.
Very, very good point, yes. All right, well, thank you so much, gentlemen. We'll see you in a few weeks.
Thank you for having us, Emily.
Up next, we've got the Oshkosh EAA here to tell us all about a really cool event coming up called Hops and Props. We'll be right back.
Granddad, it's me. An accident in Mexico. I'm in jail.
Jimmy, is that you?
Yeah,
it's Jimmy. I need money for bail right now.
In jail?
You need to send money right now. Please don't tell anyone.
Scammers are tricky and can pretend to be anybody in any situation. They seem like the real deal. They play on your fears. The goal? To get you to act fast. Check out if they really are who they say they are, even if they sound like a loved one. Heard from an imposter? Report it at ftc.gov/imposters.
Oshkosh Media is government programming on GovTV, community programming on LifeTV, community radio on Oshkosh FM 101.9 WOCT, online at oshkoshmedia.org, YouTube, and Facebook.
Welcome back to Oshkosh Today. Thanks again for joining us. And now we're joined by our friends from EAA. I have Kelly Zanders here to tell us all about one of the coolest events in Oshkosh is Hops and Props. So Kelly, welcome and thanks for joining us today.
Thanks for having me, and I'd have to agree with you. Hops and Props is my favorite event, especially at EAA. I absolutely love it.
Yes, and it's so unique. You know, as craft beer has come to fruition here the past 10 years or so, we're like at the best time for this mecca that's going on. And maybe you can just give us a little bit of an overview of what exactly Hops and Props is.
Sure. So Hops and Props is coming up on Saturday, March 4th. It's an event that has about 300 different beers for people to try over a three-hour span. So it's incredibly exciting. There's lots for people to try, whether it's one of your local favorites that you've had multiple times or something new that you want to try. We have plenty on hand. But throughout that three-hour span, we do have heavy hors d'oeuvres, which are provided by the Machine Shed. And we also have live entertainment that's going to be featured throughout the evening as well.
Oh my gosh. So 3 hours of fun packed into that short amount of time.
Yes.
I mean, how many beers did you say?
Over 300. Yes.
So not recommended to try every single beer.
No, I don't think that's possible. But definitely try to just take a little taste and a little sample of something new and unique. That's really what we want to do. We want to feature some new and upcoming beers that are maybe new to the area or new to the state. This is really what it's all about. So we really want everybody to kind of dabble in a little bit of something unique and different.
So much fun. And maybe you can give us a little bit of a preview. What are some of the, obviously there'll be a lot of local Wisconsin beers there. Any favorites or anything that people tend to come back for?
Yes, definitely. Well, you know, there's the Miller products that will be on hand. We will also have Spotted Cow, Liney's, things like that. So those are always local popular favorites of ours. But we do have some new and upcoming brewers that haven't been on hand in the past. Some of those include Black Rocks, Shorts, Revolution. So I want to say right now we're looking at about 10 to 15 new brewers that are going to be on hand. So we're really excited.
Very cool. So if you've been to Hops and Props before, you have not tasted them all, I can guarantee you that.
Yes,
it's
most
definitely worth coming back for. And, you know, besides the Wisconsin and the local beers, are there other breweries that are coming in from outside of the area too?
Yeah, we have them actually from all over the country. So our distributors are really, like I said, bringing in some new and unique different beers that I don't think a lot of people have gotten their hands on quite yet. And that's, like I said, what this event is really all about. We really want people to come in and try something different because we do have a lot of repeat attendees. So we want to make sure that we want to make sure that they have a variety every year when they come.
Yes. And you mentioned entertainment. So
yes,
it's not just about the beer. There's a lot of great entertainment there too. Who are we looking at for entertainment this year?
So we're really excited. We're going to have Patty Grass back, and they're an Irish band, and they are one of our favorites, which is why they're going to be back. I believe this is their third consecutive year at the event. We also have Kyle Megna and Ross Catamaran. And they're with Kyle Megna and the Monsoons, and they're going to be on hand providing some great music. And then also new are Dueling Pianos, Piano Fondue. And so this is very new and exciting. It's great and interactive with the crowd. So we're really excited that the lineup has tweaked a little bit, but we're also excited to have some repeat entertainment back as well.
Definitely. Holy cow, the entertainment alone is worth coming for. And
right,
the Irish kind of music is like perfect for this kind of event too.
Yes, yes. I think it's going to give everybody a great variety depending on what area of the museum they're in.
And then of course the heavy hors d'oeuvres, like you mentioned, very important if you're trying a lot of beers to have a little something to munch on. What are we looking at this year for that?
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of finger foods, things that are easy for people to walk around so they can have a drink but also have some food in hand. But there's going to be 5 different stations set up throughout the museum.
Wonderful.
And every station is going to have something different. There'll be desserts, there'll be sliders, a lot of things, so you'll definitely have a good base as you're going around and sampling all the different beers.
Perfect. And I always have to say, maybe people should think about booking an Uber or something to and from if they're going to plan on indulging in a lot of samples too.
Yes, definitely. And everyone is welcome to leave their vehicles at the museum overnight.
Perfect.
They don't have to worry about being towed or anything like that. We want everybody to be safe and call Uber or taxi or something like that.
Wonderful. And then, you know, this is the regular admission that we just talked about, but there's also even more that you can get with the VIP experience. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, so VIP is selling actually like crazy right now. We're really excited to have Beckett's on hand again for the VIP dinner caterer. So we have an amazing menu from them, and they are actually working with Left Hand Brewing, who is our VIP brewer out of Colorado. So we are really excited to have both of them on hand. One thing that's new is we are going to be starting the VIP dinner slightly earlier. Everyone can come at 4:30 and enjoy a welcome beverage, and the dinner will start at 5. This way all the VIP dinner guests have some time to really sit down, learn a little bit about each course and the pairings, and take their time enjoying the meal. And then even if they're done before 7 o'clock, the cool thing about being a VIP is you can go and wander and try those samples in the general event before it opens to everybody at 7 o'clock. So
nice.
This way people kind of have some more time with the dinner, but to also get possibly a head start with the sampling at the general event.
Yes. Oh my gosh, so much fun. So many local beers and local restaurants helping out. And you know, if a lot of people tend to shy away from beer tastings because they're not beer people, mm-hmm. That is not the case with this one. There's other beverages and stuff that are available for people to taste as well.
Sure. So obviously beer is our main focus here, but we do have Festival Foods, who's our presenting sponsor again this year, and they're going to be offering wine at their booth. We also have a few people that are going to be providing ciders and meads for people to taste and try. And then we'll have soda and water as well if people just want to come. Again, the ticket price is worth it just if you want to come listen to some great entertainment, have some great food. I mean, I really don't even recommend people eating beforehand because there's so much there. Mm-hmm. So you do get a lot out of your ticket price, even if you aren't into beer. There's a lot more for you to do while you're there.
Definitely. Let's talk about tickets. Mm-hmm. General admission costs how much?
So general admission is $65 mm-hmm. if you are an EAA member. If you're a non-member, it's $75. Okay. And then for the VIP, it's $125 and members get it for $115. Now, the day of the event, the ticket price does go up for both. If VIP is still available for $10 more, so we do recommend that you get your tickets in advance.
Mm-hmm. And we highly recommend you get going on those VIP tickets.
Yes, definitely.
It often sells out.
It does. It typically sells out a couple weeks before, and like I said, this year we're selling ahead of par, which we're really excited about. So if you're interested, we do have the menu for the VIP dinner on our website.
Okay.
So you can definitely check out what's going to be available that evening. But I can guarantee you, with Beckett's and having a new brewer Left Hand, it's going to be an incredible pairing.
Yes. So get those tickets, people. And EAA's website is simplyeaa.org, correct?
Yes. And then it's /hopsprops to access the Hops and Props page.
Perfect. You can find all the information there. Will there eventually be any lists of brewers or anything that we can expect?
Yes. So we're finalizing our registrations this week, so we're hoping to have everything posted by the end of the month. So
wonderful.
Stay tuned for that.
Which makes it even more exciting. You can kind of look forward to, you know, okay, I'm going to hit this one and that one.
Yes. A lot of people like to plan that in advance, but the beautiful thing is you'll be able to have access to that list on your mobile phone. I mean, when you're going around, just pull that up if you're looking for certain brewers. We'll have access to the map. Plus, we'll also have hard copies of the tasting guide so people can go around and take notes and things like that.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
You make it too easy for us. For those, if we try something that we really, really like, is there going to be any beer available for purchase at the event, or do we have to kind of look elsewhere for that?
You cannot purchase beer at the event. However, beers that are available at Festival Foods will be labeled. So at the booth,
perfect.
If you see a beer you really like, just look for that Festival Foods label. And the beautiful thing is Festival provides almost any of these. So I'd be surprised if they didn't offer all of them.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, definitely most of these will be at Festival or your nearest convenience store and grocer.
Wonderful. Oh my gosh, so exciting. So many great things. Last question, I guess, is what's the history behind this event? A lot of people would not typically associate EAA with craft beer. So how did this even come about?
Well, we're in our 13th year, and it's just become one of EAA's staples. We are really excited, and I think we want people to know EAA isn't just Air Venture. You know, obviously, we are so proud and honored to hold an event like that every year, but there's so much more that we do. So in addition to Hops and Props, we also have other events that take place year-round. We have September Swing, which is a 1940s-style hanger dance. We have Christmas in the Air, which is a free event that's open to the public, and it brings in about 6,000 attendees. And then upcoming, we have our ski plane fly-in, which is amazing because we have planes fly in on skis and land in the snow, and we offer free soup, and it's kind of like a celebratory event for people to come over to our hangars and check out the ski planes up close.
Definitely. And we're going to have you on the next episode for the ski planes as well, so I don't want to give too much away with that one.
Yes.
But it's going to be so cool. And I should mention too, as you're coming to these events, you also get a chance to come into the museum, and it's so cool to just look around and see all the different planes on display too.
Yeah, that's another great thing. I mean, with the purchase of your ticket, you are getting admission to the museum, and that's amazing in my book because there's so many different exhibits for people to check out while they're there. The atmosphere and environment you're in is just different and unique in its own way.
Yes. Well, so exciting. Thank you so much for coming in and telling us everything about this event. Once more, if you just want to recap the date and time for us so we can mark our calendars.
Sure. It's Saturday, March 4th. Again, VIP dinner. The new time is 4:30 for the welcome cocktail and 5 o'clock for the dinner. And then the general event is 7 to 10 p.m.
Perfect. And keep an eye on EAA's website for any updates and all the great information to come for this event. So,
definitely.
Kelly, thank you so much for coming in. And
thank you.
We'll see you soon.
Sounds good. Thanks.
We're going to take another quick break, and when we return, we'll meet our second Friends of OCM Student Athlete of the Year finalist. We'll be right back after this.
It's not a charity, it's more than a charity. It's about helping people we live with. It's about being the type of person that the 6-year-old version of ourselves wanted us to be. It's about community and looking out for one another. It's about money, yes, but it's so much more than money. It's about friendship and common values. It's about opening doors when others are slammed shut. It's about giving kids a place to be kids and growing up knowing they live in a community that cares about them. It's about making sure that everyone gets to see the dentist, because we want to make sure that they have every last tooth in those smiles. Ultimately, that's it. It's about the smiles, old smiles and new smiles. It's about us, all of us, our community living united, because great things happen when we live united. Will you join us?
Welcome back to Oshkosh Today. Thanks again for joining us. You might notice we're no longer in the studio. We've taken a little trip over to Oshkosh North. We're here in their gymnasium, and we are about to interview one of our Student Athlete of the Year finalists from the Friends of OCM. His name is Jack Sitter, and he is here with his coach, Chris Kujawa, here to tell us a little bit more about yourself and why you might be one of the Friends of OCM Oshkosh Student Athletes of the Year. So, Jack, thank you so much for having us out here today. I know you have a very busy schedule with practice and exams, and so it's kind of fun to be able to come out to Oshkosh North and see us. So thanks for having us.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Yes, and Coach, you are Jack's coach for football.
Correct.
And how long have you known Jack?
the 4 years that he's been at North High School, and then, you know, I've remember him from youth camp on occasion. You know, he had about 3 years where he was a participant in our youth camp, and he had an older brother that played for us. So I've known him probably for a grand total of 7 years.
Wow, so no stranger to
Definitely not.
To Mr. Jack here. Jack, how long have you been playing football? I mean, you know, coach says you started at quite a young age, and you're also a hockey player. So kind of give us a little bit of history, I guess, on your athletics.
So it all started when I was in kindergarten. My parents put me in Y football. Went through flag football, transitioned to tackle fourth, fifth grade, and then went to the Eagles. I actually quit football eighth grade year. I just wasn't feeling it at that time, and then came around freshman year and decided to join up again and loved it since. Mm-hmm. And with hockey, I started at 8 years old with the Learn to Skate program at the Y. Everything starts at the Y. So I did that and fell in love with it and kept on playing at the club sports there at the Y, moved to Neenah, Appleton, and now I'm back here in Oshkosh playing high school hockey. So.
Wonderful. So you've basically a lifelong player of both these sports. Can I ask you which one your favorite is?
Oh boy.
Or should I not ask that question?
Well, you know,
see Coach saying football.
it has to be football. Hockey used to be my love, but after the past 4 years, it has to be football
by
far.
Yeah. Awesome. And Coach Kujawa, you've worked with Jack for quite a while. What can you say about your experience with him as an athlete?
Well, you really don't find a harder working kid. He's extremely reliable. One of our captains this year, he really personifies what you look for as a coach in a program, in the fact that you've got somebody that's reliable, you can count on. He is a great representation of our school and our program. Always carries himself with the utmost class. You know, you just don't get kids with this kind of work ethic and character. So, you know, it's been an absolute pleasure to work with him for the last 4 years. He's one of a kind of a special young man.
Awesome. So you kind of like him then, huh?
Absolutely. If I had a daughter, I'd actually allow him to date her.
Oh, so. Wow. They must really like him then.
I don't have any daughters, so I don't have to worry about that. But he would be on the short list
for sure.
Of candidates.
Yeah, very, very cool. Well, you guys have a great relationship, coach-athlete relationship. But football and hockey are not the only thing that you're busy with. You are very busy outside of your athletics. In addition to all of your academics, you have a love for aircraft. Maybe you can kind of tell us where that started and where that came from.
That started when I was young as well. My parents would always take me to EA Air Venture every year. And so just being around the airplanes that whole week and hearing them fly overhead, I just fell in love with airplanes and so forth. And it wasn't until, I want to say 2 years ago, where I actually fell in love with it. And I decided to find a volunteer opportunity with EAA. And so I got my volunteer hours for different school clubs through that. And I applied with the EAA Kermit Weeks Hangar. And there I work on old aircraft, such as the B-25 project that's going on right now. It's an old World War II bomber. And I'm having a blast working on that. And there's other aircraft in there. The B-17 comes in once in a while. So I'm having a lot of fun working on different airplanes and things like that. So.
That's fascinating. Wow. So that alone is a huge time commitment in addition to everything else you do. How do you manage all of your priorities and your you know, responsibilities, I guess?
Well, it's a vast framework in my mind, but I count everything to the minute. And I prioritize homework first, well, family first, homework second, and just go through what needs to be done by the certain time periods that I have, and just go from there. And whenever I have free time, I go in, volunteer on the weekends, and get other work done along the way.
That's awesome. Keeping busy, but keeping the priorities in order is very important. And Coach, would you agree that sounds like a pretty organized person, and I guess how do you see that benefiting him in his future as he moves on to college?
Well, again, as you listen to him speak, it's pretty special to think of all of the things that he's involved in, and he excels at every one of them. He, you know, is a fantastic student, 4.0. Again, is the consummate professional when you see him around the building, someone that, you know, kids should look up to. And when he has spare time, you know, it's done giving back to others. So he truly understands selfless service. It's never been about Jack. It's always been about what can I do to help to make things better. And that's, you know, whether it's the community, whether it's his school, whether it's our football program, whether it's the youth kids, you just don't get kids like this. These are 1 in 25 year people that you have in front of you.
Especially in you know, this age group, I think it's a rare quality to find.
I would agree wholeheartedly.
Yeah, Jack, you have a love for aviation. You're currently involved in it. Do you plan to carry that on after high school and into college?
I do. My main goal in the future is to fly with the United States Air Force, and so beginning as a kid, falling in with aviation, and going through high school, volunteering at EAA, just grew my love for it, and I decided that going through the military is my best option right now.
But you still plan to go to college. You've made, we were talking about some of the applications you have out there right now, pursuing physics major. Tell us a little bit about that and, you know, why you like physics.
I don't know how I got into physics, but it must have been through all the books my aunt gave me. I just fell in love with science and space and realized that physics is a main part of that. So, after taking physics one sophomore or junior year and taking cat physics this year, I just realized how fun it is to just crack open the books and do the problems. And
that makes one of us.
But yeah, I plan to pursue a major in physics or somewhere along the lines of aerospace engineering in college.
Wow. So I feel like we'll probably be reading your name in the newspaper someday.
Maybe.
Well, Jack, it's been a pleasure getting to know you a little bit better. And Coach, thank you so much for stepping in and giving us some great insight on this awesome guy. Best of luck to you in your last semester, I guess I could say, or quarter of high school. And we hope to hear from you very soon. So thanks, Jack.
Thank you.
We're going to take a quick break on Oshkosh Today, and we'll return with a segment of Focus on Health with our friends at Aurora. This segment focuses on vascular diseases. We'll be right back.
I save energy. It's what I do. I never stream through my game console. I recycled my old refrigerator. I scrape, but never pre-rinse dishes. And I always adjust my thermostat when I'm out. How do I know to do all this? I go to EnergyStar.gov. Going anyplace else would be a waste of energy. For me, the simple choice is Energy Star.
Oshkosh Media is government programming on GovTV, community programming on Life TV, community radio on Oshkosh FM 101.9 WOCT, online at oshkoshmedia.org, YouTube, and Facebook.
This Focus on Health segment is brought to you by Aurora Healthcare.
Hello and welcome to Focus on Health. I'm Ted Stefaniak. Today we're at the Aurora Medical Center in Oshkosh. We're going to be speaking with Dr. Gurjeet Kalecka, and we're going to find out exactly what a vascular surgeon does. Well, thank you for taking some time with us today, and we're talking about your specialty. You're a vascular surgeon, so let's get into that. What is basically a vascular surgeon do?
Yeah, so my name is Gurjeet Kalecka. I'm a board-certified vascular and endovascular surgeon. So vascular surgery is a very comprehensive approach to a lot of diseases, vascular diseases, including carotid disease, peripheral arterial disease, venous disease, dialysis access, and aortic aneurysms. We are the only specialty that are expertise and fully trained to deal with all the disease processes of vascular disease, including minimally invasive surgery, endovascular interventions, as well as open procedures, as well as medical management of each of the diseases.
So you're relatively new to Aurora, but your history, you've been in Wisconsin a long time. You left the state for a little bit, but family, and you're a Wisconsin guy, aren't you?
Yeah, I was actually, my family migrated from India to Wisconsin in 92. So this is where I finished my high school in Racine, Wisconsin. And I did my undergrad in University of Wisconsin, Madison. And it's basically coming back home now to the family. So
now, vascular diseases, it's a pretty vast area. What are some of the diseases that somebody would be recommended for you? Because a person wouldn't necessarily contact you. They'd be referred to you for various illnesses.
Correct. So we, as a vascular surgeon, we provide comprehensive care for both minimal invasive as well as open surgeries. So we treat carotid disease, which is the main artery supplying blood to the brain. So we offer open carotid surgery, which is opening the neck up and removing the plaque and putting a patch on it, as well as minimal invasive carotid stenting in high-risk patients. In addition, we also do abdominal aortic aneurysm, which is a dilation of the aorta in the abdomen area. We treated that with endovascular minimal invasive approach by making a small groin incisions and putting a stent graft. As well as, if needed, we can also do open procedure, which means a long cut in the abdomen area and removing the aneurysm altogether and attaching a tube graft to it. We also do peripheral arterial disease. We do medical management as well as minimal invasive approach, including a groin puncture and fixing the peripheral arterial disease with ballooning, stenting, atherectomy, and even do an open surgical bypass if needed. We also manage varicose veins and spider veins. We typically start with the ultrasound and conservative management, including compression stockings. Then we also have minimally invasive approach, including ablation of the greater saphenous vein using radiofrequency ablation techniques, and also making small nicks and taking the veins out, as well as sclerotherapy, which is injecting the spider veins. We also treat kidney disease, including kidney stenting, as well as stenting of the mesenteric arteries. So patients who have abdominal angina, which is basically after eating food, if they get pain after eating, they may have blockage in the intestinal arteries. So we also treat that with stenting as well as open bypass surgery.
So doctor, if obviously a stroke is a pretty severe symptom, but outside of a stroke though, I would imagine yearly checkups, having your blood pressure, things like that can also identify potential problems?
Yeah, so coronary artery disease is a disease of people who have high blood pressure, smoking history, and diabetes, and as well as high cholesterol. So all these things need to be managed properly and keep under tight control to keep the disease from progressing. So this is where your primary care physician as well as your vascular surgeon comes into management of these pre-diagnostic risk factors.
I understand you also treat varicose veins and spider veins.
Yes, we also treat varicose veins and spider veins. It's a fairly common problem, especially in women. So approximately 50% of the women above the age of 50 will have varicose veins. That can be related to either standing jobs, pregnancy, female gender, and also genetics and family predisposition.
All right, sounds very good. Thanks for taking some time with us today.
Thank you.
Now, if you have any questions about vascular disease, you can always check with your primary care provider during your annual exam. If you have more questions, you can always give us a call at 303-8700. I'm Ted Stefaniak, and we'll see you next time on Focus on Health.
This Focus on Health segment has been brought to you by Aurora Healthcare.
Ted, and it looks like that's going to do it for this episode of OshKosh Today. Thank you so much again for joining us. Make sure you tune in to Life TV for all of your community programming. Search for OshKosh Media on Facebook or YouTube for exciting news and updates, as well as videos of your favorite programs. Make sure you follow at City of OshKosh on Twitter to receive down-to-the-minute updates about what's going on in your city. And you can also listen to OshKosh Today and other programs on the radio at 101.9 OshKosh FM, which is also streaming online and on the TuneIn radio app for mobile devices. For more information about OshKosh Media, programming schedules, and video on demand, visit our website at oshkoshmedia.org. And of course, if you'd like to be a guest on the show, you can email me at espringstro@ci.oshkosh.wi.us. As always, thank you again for joining us on OshKosh Today, and we'll see you next time.
OshKosh Today was supported in part by the Friends of OCM. And Aurora Healthcare, 855 Northwest Haven Drive. Set design provided by House of Flowers, 1920 Algoma Boulevard. OshKosh Today,